Schools in Arizona and 45 other states are implementing new academic standards to make students more globally competitive and better prepared for college and career. Here to tell us more about Arizona's Common Core standards is Dr. Denise Birdwell, Superintendent of the Higley Unified School District, and Jaime Molera, President of the State Board of Education. Good to have you both here. Thanks for joining
us. Happy to be here.
Let's start with a definition here. What is Common Core?
Well, the Common Core is a set of standards that drives instruction within a classroom. It's what we build the curriculum around. It's a larger picture that drives the learning to every student.
Okay, it sounds like it's different than what we do now, but still, you're still talking teaching, aren't you?
I hope we are. Well, what I think, it's a focus on the key academic areas a kid needs in order to be successful once they leave high school, so that they won't need the remedial classes if they go on to higher education, whether it's a comm college or universities. That's been a huge problem throughout the years, where you have folks say they graduated from a high school in Arizona, they might need remedial coursework, and really Common Core should be able to fix that. You're giving them the skills necessary to be competitive.
When did Arizona adopt Common Core standards?
The State Board adopted it in 2010. We then just adopted the process by which how we're going to test that, the assessments that go with it. So we've developed a framework that allows school districts to understand 2014 we'll have the last of the AIMS test. It'll phase out for kids that didn't pass it. So according to the law, it says you have to have a graduation assessment, so we'll still keep that. But part comes in earnest in 2015.
And before we get to differences in the way that kids would be taught with this new method, mention the AIMS test. Adios here coming up shortly. Compare the AIMS test to what we will be seeing with this new PARC test.
Well, you know, when you look at the AIMS test, you're talking in comparison to looking at the difference between a multiple choice kind of driven test to a data-based analysis kind of a assessment, where the writing is much more critical, the reading is much more critical in a PARC type of assessment, and the rigor is higher. So students have to apply the mathematical knowledge rather than just look at the discrete skills and how they use mathematics. That is going to be a significant difference for our students. So the skill level is higher. The application of the knowledge is higher, so there will be a significant difference in our assessments.
It sounds like a significant difference as well for teachers and those assessing these tests. I mean, no longer do you say B is wrong and A is right. You've got to now read the sentence and make sure it makes sense.
Well, absolutely. It's not only the content and the text, but also the academic vocabulary pieces that will apply in this, along with evidence-based answering. And so a student isn't just going to pick an answer. They have to actually defend the answer.
Are teachers ready for this? Because I go back to the idea of not just looking at a grid here. You've got to really listen, read, and comprehend what the kid is trying to get across.
Well, a lot of it does fall into school districts to get ready. I mean, quite frankly, I know a lot of school districts, like Denise's school district, Higley, has started since 2011 in preparation for this. The State Board, the reason we took our actions early was to give that signal, saying we are going down this path. We want them to understand when it's going to be applied so that they can get teachers geared up for when the assessments hit.
How many school districts, schools in general, have already adopted?
I think you have the majority of the school districts already moving in this direction. I think you can clearly see that. What I'm concerned about are some of the small rural districts, charter schools. But those are the kinds of things we're working on now to give them the resources, technical skills. The State Department, John Hoopenthal, has been great about getting out there and giving them training to get them ready.
So let's go into a classroom. How does the Common Core standard, how do those lessons, that program, how does that differ from what is currently being taught?
Well, it depends on the grade level that we're talking about. And this is a pre-K through senior level change. So the changes at the high school level, for instance, although it's English language arts and mathematics driven, every subject area has responsibility for the learning of the Common Core. So every teacher has to look at, how do I teach writing? How do I teach reading? What's the application of mathematics? So for instance, in a social studies classroom, you're going to have application of mathematics embedded within the teaching. So you have to look at your curriculum and go through and make sure that the standards are incorporated in every subject area.
Something along the lines of where there may be a social study on poverty in America with numbers and facts and figures, the students would then have to apply those facts and figures to the story? category?
Well, not only would they have to apply, they have to analyze, synthesize, and be able to explain possible solutions to those issues using the evidence from the text that they're reading. So you have reading in the content as well as contextual interpretations that the students will need to go through. Those are higher level critical thinking kinds of skills that we're talking about with students.
Are we ready for those higher levels? I mean, it's one thing to say analyze this particular report. It's right. Another thing for the kid to be able to analyze.
No, that's a great question. Well, one of the things we have to do is not just at a local level, but at a state level too. Let's look at the state policy. Let's look at the systems that govern what we're doing. I appreciate Governor Brewer talking a lot about this, talking about the kinds of resources that are going to be needed. The other thing I think is important is that you're starting to see a much deeper focus in this. Tomorrow, for instance, you're going to have a joint committee of the House Commerce Committee, along with the House Education and Higher Education Committees, meeting jointly just on this issue. They're going to have CEOs of our major industries and the major business groups talk about how important it is, not from just an academic perspective, but from business leaders, saying we need to have those kinds of skills that Denise is talking about so that it translates into Arizona being more competitive.
It sounds like more creativity, again, as you mentioned, more analysis, maybe just getting a kid to think for themselves. Is that the idea here, the impetus?
It's part of it, because when we look at the skills necessary in the business world as we go forward and look at preparing that learner for career and college readiness, you're talking about communication, collaboration, analysis, being able to have the critical thinking skills to analyze a problem, solve a problem, using all of the knowledge that I have. So in that classroom, it's not so pedagogy or subject-driven. This is taking and breaking down those isolations of learning and actually saying we all have to come together and integrate the learning process so that we cross from the sciences into the social studies, into the mathematics, and we come together in that aspect. And that is reading and writing skills. And not every teacher embraces that, hey, I'm a writing teacher. But no, I teach social studies. Not in the future. You will teach reading, you will teach writing, you have academic vocabulary development. That's a new process for teachers.
It sounds like rote memorization might be a thing of the past with this particular program.
Well, not only rote memorization, and also direct lecture. There's a place and time for lecture, but you will not see as much of it in a classroom in the future because we have to allow the students to explore and learn from the texts in which they are going to be exposed to. And that's a lot less teacher directed.
Now, compare now, if you would, what would happen maybe in an early K through 12 situation and in the high school level. I mean, is it different? Do you approach this differently? How does that work?
Well, and Denise can give a lot more specifics than I can, but the way I see it, we used to have standards that were a mile wide and an inch deep. And I think what this does, it gives more focus on those fundamental areas, like I talked about, those core academic areas that kids need in order to be successful. But it also gives, in the other subject matters that students take, it puts an emphasis on why they need to incorporate those essential skills in whatever they're studying, whether it's computer graphics, whether it's social studies. All of those things need to have strong mathematics, writing, and reading skills.
Is this mandated from on high somewhere? Is this a national mandate, state? How does that work?
Well, no, this is a consortium of states, and it was really business-driven. You had the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, you had U.S. governors, the Governors Association talking a lot about why we need to have a better system, and that's how this ended up developing.
Are our teachers ready for this system?
They will be ready. I think that part of our teachers are ready today. Training began, like I said, in our district. We started as soon as the state board gave the direction. So January 1 of 2011, we began the process. We've already integrated into East Valley. Many of the districts have come together. We've collaborated. We've worked jointly to make sure that curriculum shifts have occurred, instructional practices are changing. And certainly by August, in many districts, we will be ready.
So again, to be clear, something in Colorado or something in Nevada, that would be different than what kids might be taught here in Arizona. There is no national standard here.
The Common Core standard itself could be seen between states, between districts. However, the actual content of how that's taught, the actual curriculum that's used to teach that standard, may vary from school to school, grade to grade. You should see commonality within a school, though. Third grade teachers will have a common curriculum that they're using to deliver that standard.
What about faster learners, slower learners, higher performing schools, lower performing schools? How do you work that dynamic?
Well, I think, and that's where the assessment piece of this and the accountability piece goes hand in hand with Common Core. Right now under AIMS, we really, from a state level perspective, only test four times, third grade, fifth grade, eighth grade, and then ultimately the graduation test, which really isn't graduation test. That's the myth. It's only a 10th grade exam. That's the level of what students learn. PARC starts from the get-go. So we're able to assess on a yearly basis. So if you have kids that are progressing faster, it allows the parents and the teachers and administrators to put them on that faster track so that they're not bored in school. Conversely, if you have kids that are struggling, it allows educators and parents to define what's wrong, how do we get those interventions so they're not waiting multiple years in order to take action. To me, that's the exciting piece of this.
What about funding?
Well, funding is key, and I think it's important that we recognize we have to utilize our existing funding better, in my opinion. I think educators around the state need to redeploy some of their resources and embrace. This is the common element. This is their fundamental task as educators. But let's also recognize the technology that's needed, for instance. If you're going to move to end-of-course assessments and every-year assessments, we need to give the schools the resources and the equipment in order to do that.
Last question. People are listening to this. They're hearing Common Core. They're hearing PARC test. They're saying, this is brand new. What's going on here? It sounds like a big change. How do we know that this is a change for the better? How do we know this is best for Arizona school kids?
Well, first of all, let's just say that school reform is better for children. So as we look forward, we should always get better at our craft and our practice and what we're doing in the educational field. We know more about how a student learns than we've ever known, so we need to improve that process. The Common Core was designed by experts in the field, research-based, teachers were involved. So those who actually deliver the knowledge, the craft, have been a part of the process. And I think that's a critical part of any reform. And that's why I think it will be successful. It does have the expert, the researchers, and the teachers behind it.
And it sounds like it has public policy folks who are saying, we can fund this, we will support this.
Correct. Governor Brewer has made it a big piece of her legislative agenda for the year. Speaker Tobin, like I said, by giving it the focus, I think I'm very optimistic on getting this done.
All right. Good information. Good to have you both here. Thanks for joining us.
You're welcome.